got the organist. That's my thing.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray for pure hearts to worship God. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill.
Be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, give us the increase of faith, hope, and love, and that we may obtain what you have promised. Make us love what you command. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading today is from the 8th chapter of Deuteronomy, beginning with the first verse. The whole commandment that I command you today, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply, and go in and possess the lands that the Lord swore to give you to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you, and he let you hunger, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills you can dig copper. And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. This is the word of the Lord. Our psalm today is Psalm 34, beginning with the 8th verse, and we'll play this responsibly by the whole verse. O taste and see how gracious the Lord is. Blessed is the one who trusts in him. The lions lack and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord shall lack nothing that is good. Who among you desires to live and longs to see good days? Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is within them, due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus. To put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." So the Jews grumbled about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They said, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus answered them, "Do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'And they will all be taught by God.' Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
This morning I'm going to have everyone pray for each other. So if you can find somebody next to you and lay your hand on their shoulder. And if you're alone, step closer to somebody and pray for them. Nobody's allowed to pray by themselves this morning. You got to find somebody. All right. Let's pray together. Repeat after me. Lord, I thank you for this person next to me. I thank you that they are your servant. I thank you that you have brought them into this place this morning. May this word transform their hearts, that they may become more like your Son. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. So a lot of times you'll start off a sermon by telling a story, but this morning our text is so good that I don't think I need a story. I'm just going to start with the first verse. So verse 37 reads, and this is from John chapter 6, verse 37. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. I think this is so important for us, and I think honestly, we could probably spend a morning just thinking about this one verse, because our entire life in Christ is confidence. It's a confidence that he will never cast us out. That when we come to Jesus, he loves us so much that he will keep us, he will hold us fast. Jesus also talks about how we are in him and how he is in the Father, and the Father is in him. And so there's this kind of, you know, you see those little Russian dolls? Is that, they stack inside? Yeah. That's almost like what we are in Christ, right? We are so wrapped in Jesus. We are so wrapped in God that we can't be lost. He will never cast us out. And some people will say, well, not me. I'm too bad. God would never forgive what I did. You don't know what kind of person I am. You don't know the things I've done. Well, I've seen the people in the Bible, and I can tell you, you're not any worse than Moses, who murdered a man. You're no worse than Jesus, or Jesus not worse, but you're no worse than Paul, who went around persecuting Christians and put them in jail, right? So there's no way that you can tell me that what you did or what you are doing is worse than anything else, you know, that anyone else has done that God has received, right? God uses the weak people for his kingdom. So verse 37, the Father draws us to Jesus, and Jesus will never cast us out. Let's look at verses 38 through 40. It reads, "For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." These verses teach us that we are secure in Christ if we remain in Christ. Let's look at also John 15, 6 through 8. John 15, 6 through 8. Which reads, "If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me, and my word abides in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given or be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples." So prove to be my disciples. Does God lead us to himself? Does God the Father lead us to Jesus, draw us to Jesus? Yes. But are we also responsible to cooperate and to actually respond to that call? Yes. And so we must abide in him to produce fruit in keeping with repentance, right? We can't just go and accept Jesus and walk away and think that we're good. The Christian life is about abiding in Jesus. It's about union with Jesus. One of the unique things you'll find in Anglican theology, if you read our Anglican divines and you read our writers, they talk a lot about unity or having union with God as a means of salvation. And so when we are united with Christ, united through baptism and through Holy Communion, and most importantly, through faith, right? We are justified by our faith. And so we need to be united with Christ through all those things. And so just as a branch abides in the vine and produces fruit, we are not able to produce fruit unless we abide in Jesus Christ. We cannot become the people God wants us to be unless we abide in him. And we can't expect things to change in our lives until we start abiding in him. God has given us means for that. He's given us the church. He's given us the sacraments. Most importantly, he's given us his word, which we can go to every day and read and learn and grow in our faith. And so we cannot become his disciples, and we cannot prove to be his disciples until we do what he calls us to do, which is to know him, to grow close to him. And he's given us his word and his sacraments to do that. And so our salvation from beginning to end is the work of God. He draws us, keeps us, and raises us up on the last day. So you can have complete confidence that you will be saved and you will be raised up on the last day and you will be united with Christ and glorified and made, you know, one with all of the kingdom of heaven, right? Once you are raised on the last day. Because Jesus has promised that. All you have to do is believe in him, which also means you have to abide in him. So do you ever worry about your salvation? I know in my own testimony and Aaron's as well, and a lot of people I grew up with, we were baptized multiple times. I was baptized twice. I was baptized as a baby, but then I got baptized again in the Assemblies of God Church, which I love the Assemblies of God. Don't get me wrong. They're great. But we have to remember that our baptism is not based on our faith. Our baptism is based on what Jesus did on the cross. Our baptism is, the only reason our baptism matters is because we are united with Christ in his death. And so when we are united with in his death like him, we will be raised like him, right? That's what Paul talks about. And so if you're worried about your salvation, don't be. Don't worry about your salvation. Just go to the one who offers salvation as a free gift, which is Jesus Christ, and he will raise you up on the last day. Verses 41 through 43. So the Jews grumbled about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." Well, just saying "I am," if you remember Joe's sermon last week, just the fact that he said "ego a me," which is literally a remembering what, you know, Exodus, right? When Moses says to God, "Who should I say is sending me?" He says, "I am is sending you," right? When God tells Moses, "I am is sending you," to tell the Egyptians to let my people go, right? Jesus right here is saying, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." Verse 32, they said, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" So they're offended at him because they know his parents. They know his family. They know he's from Nazareth, right? The backwater town of Nazareth. They know that he is a penniless preacher who is basically homeless, wandering the streets, preaching repentance, right? They know who he is, and they are not impressed with his resume. But they are impressed. They are impressed with these words. And they can't put the two together. Jesus is saying, "I am," and they're saying, "Who are you," right? "I am," and they're like... So, verse 41 through 43... Jesus is superior to the Old Testament manna that came down from heaven. In the Old Testament, God rained down manna because the people were hungry and he needed to feed them. And it came down, right? And they would gather it and then they would take a day off on the Sabbath. And so they would not gather any, but they would have enough. They'd have more than they needed. And the people that gathered too much, it would get moldy, right? You guys remember that story? Okay. Anyways, Jesus is saying, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." He's saying, that bread they ate, and it was, you know, tasty. It tasted kind of like sweet honey, right? It was good stuff, but it didn't keep them alive forever. But if you eat my flesh and you drink my blood, you will have eternal life, which that doesn't help at all. That doesn't help the situation at all because it just makes them more offended at what he has to say. Because we have to see that what he's saying is not a physical eating and a physical drinking, because obviously he doesn't give us physically his body and blood in the Bible. And as Anglicans, we don't believe in transubstantiation the way that Roman Catholics do, right? We believe that we receive his body and blood through the bread and the wine in this Eucharistic meal. And we also receive his body and blood, his flesh, right? He gave his flesh on the cross. That flesh that died on the cross is our bread and wine as well. So all of it is wrapped together, and if we believe in Jesus Christ, we are fed spiritually by our faith. When we approach him in faith, he feeds us. So they grumble because of their familiarity with Jesus and his extreme language. Is our familiarity with Jesus or his extreme language an obstacle to us coming to faith in him? You know, have we been going to church our whole lives and things haven't really changed much? And so we see, we hear the same sermons. And honestly, you come to church every Sunday and you kind of get used to listening to the pastor and going home and having lunch and kind of going through the motions each week. Or do you believe that each week you should be a little bit closer to the goal? I have the privilege of counseling one of the guys in Teen Challenge. And we're just talking about, you know, in a game, right, you die. You may die in the game, but you always come back to, like, your checkpoint. But in the game, you keep playing the game, and as you go along in your game, you acquire further checkpoints, so you get closer to winning the game. But when you die, you go back to the last checkpoint. What I'm saying is, in your spiritual life, in your Christian life, when you come to church, do you actually expect to get a little bit closer to Jesus, a little bit more sanctified, a little bit more like Jesus every Sunday? Or do you just come here and go home and expect nothing to change? Or do, you know, and you're going to fall. You're going to have problems, just like in the video game, right? Sometimes you fall, and in the video game, you die. And then you go back to your checkpoint, right? You're going to have times when you fall back, and you might have to start over. Right? And you might have to work hard to kind of work on that sanctification. But at the same time, you're farther along than you were before. You're always going to get farther along. So don't get discouraged in your walk with Jesus when you fall, because you can always start over again. He's always calling you back. The parable of the prodigal son is a great example of that. Jesus is likely making a reference to the grumbling of the, or sorry, John is likely making reference to the grumbling of the Israelites in the wilderness. They grumble because of their familiarity with Jesus in extreme language. So we must be careful not to become over-familiar with Jesus, over-familiar with church, over-familiar with preaching, over-familiar with the Bible, right? Over-familiar with the sacraments. We have to approach it new and fresh every week, because God has something new for us every week, and he wants us to continue to grow. The Christian life should always be a life of growth. Verse 44. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. All our salvation is God's doing, and that's why he gets all the glory, and we cannot boast one bit. Often we want to somehow earn or contribute to our salvation, but Jesus says that even our believing is God's work. So are we trying to work hard and earn our salvation? Are we trying to work hard to become, you know, more like Jesus, or are we allowing Jesus to work in us? You need to abide in Jesus to be transformed. You can't work hard and harder and harder. You know that country song, I don't know if you guys listen to country. I listen to country a little bit. You know the song, part of the lyrics is, he's working hard to get to heaven. No, working hard to get to heaven where I come from, right? That one? You guys know what I'm talking about? Okay. Anyways, it's a little catchy, but it lacks theology, right? Like, we're not working hard to get to heaven. Jesus has done the work, and we abide in his finished work, and he helps us to become sanctified. We cooperate and become sanctified through him. So verse 45 through 47, actually, let me go back to verse 44 real quick. There's always been kind of a debate in Christianity between Calvinists and Arminians. And the Calvinists will say it's all God, everything is God, God saves us. It's monergism, right? So monos meaning one, and monergism meaning the one is the one doing all the work. And so he's saving us, he's keeping us, he's raising us up on the last day. Nothing wrong with that. I mean, it's true. But also, there's also synergism, which teaches that God comes and he moves us and he works in us and we cooperate with him and we're saved through that. Anglicans are really hard to pin down. We're not really Calvinists and we're not really Arminians. We have Calvinists and we have Arminians, and some people will argue that we're one or the other. But really, Anglicanism has kind of been an interesting soteriological theology, because we're saved by God's work, but we also recognize that we need to cooperate with God to be saved. And so when Jesus says that the Father, the only way we can come to him is if the Father draws us, we need to recognize that the Father is drawing us, but we also must respond. It's 100% God and 100% us. We both have, we're both working in this. And so verse 45 through 47, reads, "It is written in the prophets, and they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life." Those who believe in Jesus because of his words and the words of God in the Old Testament have eternal life. Jesus talks to the Pharisees because they search the scriptures, believing that in them they will have eternal life. But then Jesus says, you search those scriptures, but don't you realize they're pointing to me? All the Old Testament scriptures are pointing to him. The Father is already teaching us in the Old Testament, and the Father is continuing to teach us through Jesus in the New Testament. And if we respond to Jesus, the sheep know his voice, right? From John chapter 10, the sheep know my voice. And so if we respond, we are his own. So we shouldn't be so concerned about whether we're chosen or elect or predestined, right? That's not really the thing that we should be concerned about. What we should be concerned about is, are we responding to the call? And if you are worried about your salvation, I'm pretty confident in telling you that God is calling you. If you're worried about being saved, if you want to be saved, God is calling you. So if you have that call in your heart, respond to the free gift of eternal life in Jesus Christ. Verses 48 through 51. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. So verse 51 is important. Like I said, he is sacrificing his body on that cross. Just as in the Old Testament, there's sacrificial lamb, right? There's always these animals that were sacrificed over and over and over again to make atonement for sin, to at-one-ment, that's one way to understand atonement, at-one-ment for sin, bringing us back to the Father, becoming one with the Father again. In the Old Testament, you see all these animals getting slaughtered, right? Jesus is the one sacrifice for the sins of the world. He is the paschal lamb, the Passover lamb, who takes away all the sin of the world. And so that is the flesh that he's talking about, is that he is dying on the cross. The cross is like an altar, right? And he's dying upon it for our sins. Jesus is the physical sacrifice that is our spiritual food during our time in this world. We look on Jesus by faith. This is why we must preach Christ crucified. Without a cross, there is no salvation. That's why a lot of preachers today, you hear them talking about how you can make your marriage better in, 3 weeks or something. And that's not the point of the Christian faith. Do I want your marriage to be beautiful? Do I want your marriage to be wonderful? Yes. But the point of the Christian faith is not, short little messages or long messages about how you can make, your marriage better. The point of the Christian faith is to draw near to Jesus, to be saved from your sins and to be restored. And when you become a new creation, you will be a better husband. You will be a better wife. You will, be a better father or mother. But that's not the point of the Christian life, or it's not the point of church, is to go and hear sermons like that. You need to have a cross in your sermon, because the cross is what saves you. There is no salvation without the cross. So we look to Jesus by faith, and I love this. When I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself, all nations, Jews, Gentiles, all people will be drawn to him. And so the point of being lifted up in the wilderness, you see the serpent, the brazen serpent that's lifted up in the wilderness, right? You guys remember that story as well in the Old Testament? Well, Jesus is looking at that story, and he's saying, when I am lifted up, just like the brazen serpent was lifted up and all the people that were bit by the snakes in the wilderness were healed, you will be healed eternally, not just physically, not just for a moment, not just fed by manna for a moment, but you will be fed eternally and you will be healed eternally by Jesus when he's lifted up. And so one of the things that I'm going to encourage you as you come to Eucharist today, as you come up, Jesus was veiled in flesh as he did his ministry on earth. He was veiled in flesh. And he went around and he healed all these people of all their diseases and their various issues, right? And he told them to come in faith, to respond in faith. When you come to this Eucharistic meal today, when you come to receive this bread and this wine, Christ is veiled in this Eucharistic sacrifice, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. When we come to this bread and this wine, Jesus is veiled for us, and I pray that you would ask him to open the veil, that you would see Christ through the bread and the wine of the Eucharist, that you would see Jesus, and that Jesus would change your hearts, that you may become more and more like him through this spiritual meal together, in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Lord, I thank you for your kingdom. I thank you for the fact that you, all through the Old Testament and the New Testament, have promised to be faithful. You've promised that you will be with us through the worst times and through the best of times. And Lord, you are our bread of heaven. You are the bread that came down from heaven, and you feed us spiritually each day. You don't just give us promises, you are the promise. You are the sustenance. And when we run to you and to your word and to your sacraments and we find you, we may be nourished and we may be strengthened in our faith and we may be saved. In Jesus' name, amen.
In our worship tradition, we gather each week to thank God, to fellowship with him and with one another in praise and thanksgiving. God shows up and speaks through his scripture and the word taught. And sometimes we have a lot to think about and pray about out of that. And we also have the opportunity to profess our faith, to speak our belief. For whoever believes has eternal life, period. And so it's our opportunity to do that now, as Christians have throughout the centuries, in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, seeds from the Father and the Son. Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Kneeling or seated, let us pray for the church and for the world. For the peace of the whole world and for the well-being and unity of the people of God. Lord, in your mercy. For Foley, our Archbishop, Ryan, our Bishop, and for all the clergy and people of our diocese and congregation. Lord, in your mercy. For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others. Lord, in your mercy. For the children and youth, Give them your strength and guidance day by day, that they may continue in your love and service throughout their lives. Lord, in your mercy. For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith, Lord, in your mercy. For our nation, for those in authority, especially Joseph, our president, Greg, our governor, Patrick, our mayor, Terry, our Midland County judge, for first responders, for the military, and for all in public service, Lord, in your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for the rain that has refreshed us. We pray to receive your ongoing provision. Lord, in your mercy. For Lynn Casebeer, Barbara Chandler, Barbara Clark, Glenda Cumbest, Dan, Suzanne Dorrance, Joe Edwards, Sandra Hyde, Delilah Jeter, Alice Kalush, The Kramers, Clark Lee, Alan Lindsay, Father Henry Pendergrass, Ann Riddle, Rita Rivas, Mary Rowland, Russ Sarkees, Al Shorey, Madison Smith, Barbara Williams, and all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Lord, in your mercy. For Eric Rook and all those who have departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, in thanksgiving, let us pray. Lord, in your mercy. We pray to you also, Father, for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, whose steadfast love is as great as the heavens are high above the earth, have mercy upon us and remove our sins from us as far as the east is from the west. Strengthen our lives in his kingdom, and keep us upright to the last day through Jesus Christ, our merciful high priest. Amen. Please stand. Restored in relationship with God and with each other, we can say alleluia, the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Alleluia. Please offer each other a sign of peace. Please be seated. Celebrations, blessings today, the first of which is welcoming our wonderful, wonderful brothers who we love very much from Teen Challenge. Birthday blessings. this week, a world record for the number of birthdays we are praying for. Evelyn Dierstein, Lisa Muhorter, Brennan Adams, David Purdy, Bradley Chandler, Andrew Tang, Chan Kim, Daryl Terrain, Lorelei Rowland, Casey Weaver, Chris Purdy, Marlena Cam, Nate Knowles, and Savannah Booth. Told you, world record this week. Let's pray together. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may your peace, which passes all understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And one wedding anniversary this week, Alan and Laurie Lindsay. Let us pray for those wonderful folks and that wonderful marriage. O God, you have so blessed the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send your blessings upon these your servants, that their lives together may continue to reflect your love and forgiveness, and that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Rip?
Good morning. Welcome. Welcome. We are so grateful for you. If you're here and you're a guest, we would love to get to know you. There's a card in the seat back in front of you that says welcome. Fill that out. There's a place for you to put maybe something about yourself, but also if you want prayer or someone to reach out to you, we would love for you to fill that out and be able, and you can just drop it in the offering plate in the back as you leave today. So let's kind of walk through this week, and there will be today at 3 p.m. a Daughters of the Holy Cross meeting in room 109, and I was just informed there is not a healing prayer service today, so disregard that. Tomorrow morning, there will be Mom Gets a Break, 12 p.m., men's lunch at Mulberry Cafe. Tuesday, we will restart our men's weekly breakfast series, the 33 series for men. It's at 6:30 in the morning. Love for you to be a part of that with us. It's a great time. And then another Mom Gets a Break on Tuesday morning. Wednesday, we have morning prayer at 7 a.m., 5:45 youth night, and then 6:30 choir rehearsal. And a couple of things that I want to pass on to you that are upcoming. The blessing of the backpacks, Jonathan will speak of that in a minute. Women's coffee next Monday, August the 16th at 9:45 at Brew Street. And you can talk to Michelle Silwell if you have any questions. And youth back to school bash Wednesday, August 18th. At 6:30 to 8 p.m. at 409 South Pecos Street, and then a youth pool party with True Light, Saturday, August 21st, 3 to 5:30 at the Qualia's, and then fall kickoff, Sunday, August 22nd. This will be a combined service for all of us, 9:30, don't miss that. And finally, fall kickoff, Wednesday, August 25th. We'll start back with our dinners, our meals, and our studies that night. August the 25th, meal at 5:45. And then also, there is one more. Rockhounds Picnic, Saturday, September 18th. Make sure you sign up and get a ticket. It was a great time last time and be even better this week, this next time. So that's all I have. Anything I missed?
Thank you, Rick. Please. There is not enough going on here at Christ Church. We are privileged today, two final celebrations. One is that we do what we do here in worship only because of the help and love and service of a lot of good folks, including our wonderful acolytes. And today we are saying farewell to Jake. This good man right here, please stand. Jake, let's give him a round of applause. He has served for many years, and we have a little scholarship fund that incents this kind of good service, and he has put in hundreds of hours over 8 years serving at this altar. Somehow he graduated in May from Midland Classical Academy. Way to go, buddy. He will be attending the University of Utah at Salt Lake City, where we will all be visiting to go skiing over time. And he is going to major in musical theater and business. And we also wish accolades and thanksgivings for Carl and Caroline, his wonderful parents. Why don't you guys stand? Let's give them a round of applause too, please. Hey. Let's all pray for this good guy. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for, you know, just touching Jake's heart. He's a good man. We thank you for his parents. Lord, we thank you for his aspirations, his interests, his vocation, his education, all that he sets out to do. And Father, we ask your blessing on him, your guidance. And Lord, that we may have a great time skiing with him in Salt Lake City. In your son's name we pray. Here you go, buddy.
Thank you.
Last round of applause. Okay, last blessing and celebration is the return to school going on these days. Would all kids, all students, please come up? All students, please come up. Make it quick. Let's go. There's got to be more than one. Come on, kids. Come on, she's going to be really embarrassed if she's the only one. Okay, good man. How about one more? Okay. Oh, come on. There's only two? Okay. Well, that's good enough. We want to bless with a rock for your backpack that says, I am a child of God. And we invite all parents and grandparents and brothers and sisters and friends of returning students to come up after the service and grab one of these, stick it in the backpack as a little surprise, perhaps, okay? And let us symbolically pray for these two who represent so many. Turn around. Okay. Father God, we thank you so much for your calling, your life, your protection, and your provision. We pray blessing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that these two may be vessels of your love, may do well in class, may be examples to their classmates, may guide and give your love to others. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. You may see folks off to the side offering prayer during communion. You may also see folks after the service at the altar rail if anybody would like to come forward for healing prayer after the service. We know that we are all invited by faith. If you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and receive his spiritual presence in this communion of bread and wine, please do come forward for communion. All are invited. Hear the words of our Lord. Do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. And so let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord.
Oh,
Is the Father with us?
He is.
Is Christ among us?
He is.
Is the Spirit here?
He is.
This is our God.
Father, our Son, Holy Spirit.
And we are His people.
We are redeemed.
And so lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Seated. Almighty God, we thank you for giving up your Son to die on the cross for us who owe you everything. Pour your refreshing Spirit on us and upon these gifts as we remember him in the way he commanded through this bread and this wine. On the same night he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Amen. His body was broken for us. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, Heavenly Father, hear us as we celebrate this covenant with joy and await the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. He died in our place, making a full atonement for the sins of the whole world. You accepted his offering by raising him from death and granting him great honor at your right hand on high. Amen. Jesus is Lord. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus,
alleluia, alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia, alleluia. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Let us pray together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope that you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. All parents and grandparents, remember to come get your rock for students who need a rock in their backpack to wish them well. I am a child of God. And a final thanksgiving for you guys being with us. Teen Challenge men, we love you. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age. Let us joyfully go forth in the name of Christ to do this work he has commissioned us to do. Thanks be to God."